Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming. Session is using SSO as both a security and a business tool. So just a quick show of hands, how many of you have ever gone in and sat down in the CFO's office and said, I need to buy a security tool, and he has jumped up and said, great, how are you gonna help the business? It's more like, what is it gonna cost me, what do you need it for, right? So hopefully this will give you some talking points and some thoughts around how you can maybe approach that conversation, some metrics you can use to help support your argument as you're moving forward. So this is me. I've been doing this longer than I care to mention. Currently an InfoSec manager with a Fortune 500 based out of Central Ohio. Identity is a lot of what we do, and I've been fortunate enough to working in that space to get to where I can see how you can interact that with the business. Being a big data-driven organization as well, you get an opportunity to work with a lot of data points. So that's where some of this information has come from today. So we're looking at the regulatory environment. It's constantly changing. As you're well aware, you could get two or three different rulings in the same year around some of your regulatory and compliance issues. So SSO can help with that. Your security tools are going to become a must-have. Oftentimes, you'll see a situation where you'll have a regulatory and a compliance piece, and it says, do you have SSO? And it's a checkbox on your audit form. Are people checking that off? Are you actually leveraging the tool to show benefit from that? From a password perspective, passwords are hard to manage. They're easy to forget. The running joke in InfoSec is always look underneath somebody's keyboard to see if their password's there. Another thing, look underneath the mouse pad in case you need to know where to find one. And then if you're partnering with the business, you can help realize improved efficiencies. They're gonna help offset the cost of your security tools, not only from a cost perspective, but this is also applicable from an optimizing efficiencies as well. All right, so a little bit of background of what we're talking here. So federation, we know that provides secured authorization profile between your separate security domains based on your authorization. So when you're dealing with entitlements in the identity space, you need to figure out who the person is, are they authorized to be there, and then what are they entitled to see on the network? What can they do while they're here? It's also going to remove the necessity for a front-end user to remember all sorts of different usernames and password combinations. So the use case that I drew this from is we have a large population of call centers across the country, and we have a high percentage of our employees are actually associates that sit in these call centers. They can use anywhere between 5 and 15 different tools at any given time during a shift during the day as they're working with, taking customer calls and working with the customers that have problems, issues, questions, and concerns. So for them to try and remember 15 different passwords in the course of a day is gonna lead to password resets, loss of productivity while they're sitting there trying to remember the password or waiting to get the password reset. All right, so leveraging your federated identities, the 2018 Verizon DBIR. So you have about 19% of breaches were identified were the result of privilege misuse. So that is somebody that had an elevated account that maybe had transitioned from their old role to a new role. Maybe they didn't need to have that anymore. So those are one of the primary issues in managing your identities and making sure that your entitlements keep up with that and people just don't inherit their old entitlements as part of their new role moving forward. Are your disparate systems properly managing those identities? You can use your SSO and federation. You can leverage your existing identity stores. So you can tie this into your Active Directory. You can tie it into RACF on a mainframe site, for example. You want to try and simplify your identity stores so you don't have issues across those stores. For example, if you have a centralized identity store, you know that's going to be your authoritative source of record. But if you have 15 applications across your space and each one has a separate identity store, there's a good chance that something is going to get crossed up where somebody's going to be given entitlements they don't deserve, or the worst case, they need to have entitlements to do their job and they don't have them, which makes them unproductive in the role. It also leads to a lot of end-user anxiety and, quite honestly, resentment in some cases. If somebody says, well, I've been here for 3 weeks, I still don't have the entitlements to do my job, you're not providing a good associate experience, with retention being where it is today, especially in the InfoSec space, always something to be aware of. So we have using your directory store, like I just talked about. It's easier to maintain. You can can use your SSO and the need for API integrations, all a lot of things that folks already know, so just kind of some background. One thing to keep in mind, SAML seems to be, you know, the standard de facto. OpenID Connect is kind of layering over top of SAML, so certainly something to think about if you haven't yet as you're developing and maturing your IAM programs. So it's just a quick slide. It talks a little bit about the IAM, your circle of life here. So you have provisioning, your access certifications, your multi-factor authentications, single sign-on, and there's growth areas out of here. So this is up here. I like to use this slide to show that all the different phases and aspects of IAM all can play together if you build your program right. And if you're looking at it holistically from the life cycle of IAM within your organization. So as you start, of course, provisioning, that's making sure people have what they need to do their job, but nothing more and nothing less. So your certifications, you need to have people in the business who understand what these applications are, actually reviewing your certification site or the certification reviews to make sure what the associates have permission to do is appropriate and correct. It should not be the place of the IAM team or the access review and certification people to understand what permissions are required to do the job in that role. That should be the business unit, the business organization who owns the application. They're the ones that really understand what happens in that space and what needs to occur. So you layer in multi-factor. Of course, everyone knows that's reducing different types of attacks, password guessing, brute forcing. It's just a second layer of defense. Your single sign-on, again, is another piece of that. You can layer single sign-on with multi-factor. You can do it a bunch of different ways. And then growth areas, we're talking about privileged account management. We're talking about being able to scale your provisioning out to cloud resources and applications. Do you want to have separate identity stores in cloud versus on-prem? A lot of different things to think about there, but these just sort of how all the pieces fit together. All right, so how it works real quick, real high level, your SAML authentication, you have your two main components. You've got your IDPs, those are your identity stores. You've got your service provider. So they're the ones that have the service, the resources. That can be both internal and it can also be external. So you have to think about this, not necessarily focused entirely on-prem with your applications in your data center and your users there, but you also can think about this, SaaS providers, you know, business partners, maybe they have certain intellectual property that your people need to get to, or perhaps you're hosting intellectual property as part of a partnership, and you want to make sure that these people are properly authenticating and getting the access they need without somebody coming in and, you know, an inappropriate access to where they're able to get the data and take stuff that they shouldn't be able to see. So your SSO connection, it's either IDP initiated or SP initiated. It's going to depend on the architecture of the solution. My apologies, some of these slides, it's just for theory. I wasn't sure the slide was in here. That's why it threw me for a second. Sorry about that. So this just walks you through the different steps. It shows you the different phases. It shows you where everything lives. Talks a little bit about how you can architect that out with your browser interface and what it should look like. Here's what an SP initiated would look like. All right, so let's look at this as your security tool. So when you're looking at this from a password management perspective, here's some numbers to keep in mind, especially as the millennials are entering the workforce and the number of millennials are growing every day. So 87% of your users are between 18 and 30 years of age, and 81% of users between 31 and up will reuse their passwords across multiple accounts at the same time. So that means your payroll systems and your corporate thing are going to be the same as their Gmail accounts and the same as their Twitter accounts and the same as their LinkedIn accounts, et cetera, et cetera. So you can see where we're going with this. So without SSO, your businesses are at the mercy of the vendors, and what does their password policy look like? Can you use ABC123? Can you use password with an asterisk? Or does it have to be more complex? But there's no control at the core of your enterprise with how you want that to be handled. So the second thing that you want to think about is inappropriate access or access after termination. Inappropriate access, we've talked about that a little bit. It's like, does somebody who is at a help desk level, should they be able to go out to the payroll file share and see everybody's salaries? No, they shouldn't. So access after termination, when somebody leaves your organization, Sarbanes-Oxley, PCI, for example, require that you have a process. And there's a finite period of time where that access can still be live post-termination before it has to be turned off. Where this can become problematic is if it is a trying to think of a nice way to put this. If it's a non-agreeable termination, for example, do you still want that person to have access to your resources after they've left the building? Do you want them to go home and start uploading your intellectual property to a cloud share somewhere that they can post out to the world? Things that you have to think about. Single sign-on can help you with that. Geographic access can be based on legal requirements. For example, credit monitoring bureaus in the United States have very strict regulations around what data they have within their warehousing that can be shared internationally outside the contiguous United States. So if you're working with offshore call centers or if you're working with international and global partners, you have to be very aware of what data you're sharing and how you're doing that to prevent violation of contracts that you would have with the credit bureaus, for example, here in the United States. So again, you can use SSO to leverage how that works because there are attributes in your information store and that you get from your authoritative source of your identities that you can help build rules around that to where it would get a limited set of data or no data at all, depending on where they sit globally in comparison to your organization. So let's talk a little bit about regulatory compliance. This is a long laundry list of things here, just to show the broad impact that regulations can have on the organization. So of course, Sarbanes-Oxley, you've got Section 404, your management asset of internal controls. That's often referenced when you're talking about regulatory compliance. So anybody that's publicly traded company or organization, someone that would have specifics in relations to finances in your organization, you're all gonna be applicable to these. So you're gonna look at assigning and controlling user access rights. You're gonna be adjusting your user access rights where responsible. Anytime changes happen, you have to have documentation. One of the primary things to keep in mind here is you need to maintain an audit trail. So you need to have that initial request when the access was requested from the end user. You need to have the approvals that are tied to the access that they've requested. You need to be able to show when the provisioning occurred and that it was the appropriate provisioning. And you also need to maintain that through the life cycle of the access that they need. And then when the deprovisioning request comes in, you also need to be able to show how, when, and where the deprovisioning occurred. All very important. Some of the others that we're all beholden to, PCI DSS, HIPAA, FDIC, FFIEC. When I say the hits keep coming, the company where I work for, we currently operate under, I believe, 28 separate regulatory agencies. So it's out there. All right, so real quick, I find it's easier sometimes to kind of look at things. So if you have multiple applications without SSO control, you can see there on the left, you've got your users and the things that they're doing are all the way over there on the right, and you're passing all that through the internet. So you can have a host of different services. And again, with SaaS applications becoming more and more prevalent in the environment, I dare say that you will be seeing more and more of those coming very shortly if you're not already living in that space as it is. But as you can see, each user is tied independently to each of the applications. So you're having to maintain your identity stores across each of these applications. And that also includes the entitlements, end user lifecycle management, the whole nine yards across each one of those. And the more of these you add, as you can see, it becomes more problematic. So when you layer in your enterprise SSO, you can broker that there. Again, this is a very high level design. When I became a manager, they made me turn in my engineer hat, so I apologize for this being at the 30,000 foot level. So you have your multiple apps there on the right-hand side again, but as you can see now, your enterprise SSO through your federation has become your single point of control. So you have better visibility into what you're brokering. You have better control over the entitlements that are signed based on the single sign-on that you're doing. It also allows you to enforce separation of duties. So the person that, for example, would be processing payments to your vendors, for example, should not be the person that's also entering those. I think everybody understands separation of duties relatively well. So revoking access on termination, you have your enterprise single sign-on can tie back to your identity store. So when that termination processes through, the account immediately becomes disabled. Then that will also then disable all the SSO connections that are tied to that. So then you don't have to go back to each one of those applications there on the right-hand side and perform a deprovisioning activity. You will for cleanup, but at least from the standpoint of a regulatory requirement, you have severed access to the resources on those applications at the time the employee left the organization. And then your verifying access rights, that again can be tied into your access review and certification cycle. You're also able to look at what is happening in the transactions through the logs in your SSO to see that the appropriate people are getting to the appropriate places and vice versa. All right, so it's important to understand that SSO is a security tool. It's an identity and access management tool. It's a provisioning tool. It's a security tool, all sort of rolled into one. So as that becomes one piece of the overall defense, some of you may be aware of something that we use in the space, or at least that I'm familiar with. It's PDR. It's prevent, detect, and respond. So this all layers into that together. You're wanting to try and prevent inappropriate access or someone stealing your stuff. If you do detect that, you want to be able to utilize the tools you have available to stop it if it is going, and then that becomes the R of the response. So this is all part of the defense in depth. Requiring multi-factor authentication is going to reinforce your federated access controls. And again, there's no substitute for logging, monitoring, and alerting, especially in your critical systems. It's also very important at that point to be able to see that ahead of any problems that may be occurring. An example would be if someone were to connect to your systems and say twice a month they were uploading the same large data file as part of their job responsibilities, and it happens every morning between 9 and 10 a.m. local time. So then if you were to see that same person log on to that same system, not on the 15th or the 30th of the month, at 3 a.m. local time, if you have this information available, then you can alert that something could be going on that's inappropriate, and you'd be able to take steps to prevent a potential loss. All right, so let's talk about this as a business tool. Again, it comes back to what I said at the beginning. Not often does the IT shop show up at the CFO's office and say, hey, I have a way to like self-fund my application package and also save you money. So hopefully this will give you a few things to think about. All right, so the quote-unquote de facto standard for a long time has been, you know, an eight-character password, your alphanumeric, and your special characters. But if you think about that, many of your users are applying that same password that they have across multiple platforms, and in some cases, they're mixing their business accounts and their user accounts or their personal use accounts. So now let's think about this. If you make that more complex and you're requiring in that first part that your passwords now are 12 characters with multiples of uppercase, lowercase, you're making it more complicated for your end users to remember their passwords. So that's going to lead to forgotten passwords, writing passwords down, sharing passwords among associates, all things that are bad security hygiene in the environment. So some of the cost savings and productivity gains that you can see from this and that we've actually been able to deliver in our organization. So you have an actual help desk password reset cost, whether that's through a managed service provider or if it's an in-house help desk. Every time you call them, there's an associated cost with that. And it's very important that you understand what that is. In our case, our governance division manages and maintains all that, and I was actually able to get the exact down to the dollar amount of every call that we processed, how much that would cost. So again, it's going to be internal, it's going to be managed service provider. So the self-service password reset will help to reduce time and cost, but there's the inherent cost in the systems and the administration. And it's like everything that you buy and bring into your environment, as I'm sure you're well aware, there is a cost associated with that. So being able to speak to the cost and what it's for is very helpful. So now when your associates are going to call the help desk, they've forgotten their password. What happens? Normally they end up on hold. Then they process through hold. They finally get to the help desk person. They're able to process and work the ticket, get them resolved, and get them closed. The other piece of this is you're building audit controls for your hosted applications and your SaaS platforms. So you're able to look at what are the connections, what's going in and out. I have another point about that in a second. So here's some of the numbers that we talked about. So from a cost savings and productivity gains perspective, so we're looking at, you've got your help desk managed services. Those tickets cost ballpark, let's say it's $25 a charge every time you make a call in to do a password reset. So let's say every quarter you average 6,500 password reset tickets. The cost of the company is going to be that $162,500 per quarter, that's $650,000 a year. This is concrete savings just from the password reset costs that were associated to your organization for your associates having to call in and make and initiate a password reset. If you had single sign-on in front of this for even 25% of those calls, you're saving that, again, $162,500 a year. I know it's, trust me, the math worked out. I don't know how it was the same number. And if you're able to leverage that out to 75%, you're now saving $487,500 a year, which is a huge chunk of money. So now let's say that you are wanting to build your IAM program, or you wanted to enhance and improve your single sign-on activity. That $487,500 is going to cover some licensing costs, some training costs, and an FTE or an FTE and a half, possibly even two FTEs that you're able to self-fund through the deployment of SSO in your environment as you do this. All right, so let's look at non-productivity time from a password reset. So the average time in our environment for a SAML connection is about 10 seconds, give or take, depending geographically where the call center is located. So if you take that average time to complete the password reset with a help desk ticket is about 8 minutes. So you're looking at 10 seconds versus 8 minutes. So here's some numbers on how that breaks down from a cost savings perspective. So if you process 26,000 password resets in the course of a year, you know, you're looking at 8 minutes for each one of those. You do the math, it's 208,000 minutes or 3,467 hours. So again, we're gonna use that same 25 and 75 that we used on the previous slide. So from a 25% SSO adoption rate, that's your 52,000 minutes, 867 hours. And again, at 75%, you're looking at 2,600 hours. Now this is where, I know it's math people, and I apologize, it's right after lunch, I get that. But if your average customer call is 5 minutes, and you know that, then you can take 10,400 additional calls with the same call center staff numbers that you have in place at that point in time. So now you're reducing the necessity for your call center operations teams to have to staff up for peak times or staff down. It also gives them flexibility then to offer enhanced training times away from the phones. If any of you are familiar with call centers, a lot of the call center associates are gauged on, you know, the amount of times they're on the phones, the amount of calls that they're taking, all that ties together. So if you're able to relieve that, then you can actually give them some enhanced associate experiences, which again then ties back into associate retention. You're not having a 45 or 50% churn rate possibly in your call center associates on a regular basis. This seems to be about the average that call centers see nationally right now. All right, so let's talk a little bit about audit control for your hosted applications. So how can you even validate if your SSO services are being utilized? Again, logging and monitoring is key to that. But the reporting from your SSO tool should be able to show you how many connections that you have to all of your clients at any given point in time and how much those are actually being used. So where this drives in a critical metrics reporting space is if you have an organization, especially if you're in a highly regulated space, if you're a trading shop on Wall Street or you're doing securities, you're working in banking, financial services, things like that. Some of your clients that you take on may stipulate in the contracts up front that they require you to have a fully balanced, global, high availability, hot scenario, which you realize is gonna cost a lot of money to set that up. So you agree because you wanna keep the client happy and you want the contract, so you're rolling all that out. As you look at that though, using your SSO considerations, you can say, you're asking us to spend X thousands of dollars a year to put this in place and you only have 3 people using it. That then gives you some leverage to take to your businesses or your business relationship people. They can have those conversations back with your clients to really say, is this what we need to do? Is there some middle ground that we can find a way to make this work? So this is sort of a backdoor way to additionally help save some money and help realize your cost and investment within your organization. All right, so some soft benefits, and we've talked a little bit about a few of these already, but you're gonna build a better customer experience, especially in mobile. And what I mean by that is your customers are gonna be accessing their accounts. That's when they're in the store, they've got the mobile app open on their phone, they're wanting to do shopping, and they're having a great experience. So all that SSO is happening behind the scenes, usually through OAuth is how you're brokering all that. But the client doesn't have to keep logging back in, or they get to the point where they wanna shop, or they've got that next value coupon that they can use. You're not slowing the experience down. You're able to actually help facilitate a business use case and make it agreeable for the customer as they're using it. So again, happy customers, they're more likely to frequent the stores, the apps that they find easy to use. You're getting a competitive edge in the marketplace at that point. So from the end user experience, it's faster and easier to simply click a bookmarked link to gain direct access to needed resources than it is to remember have to look up the password. Something that I think is probably an experience that a lot of you have had. If you call a help desk to get help on something and you're talking to the help desk associate and they're like, oh, the computer's really slow today, I'm sorry, oh, I'm having trouble logging in. That kind of sets a negative tone to some regards because you called to get help, you don't have time to be waiting for all this. So if you can leverage single sign-on in front of all that at the help desk level, all they're doing is clicking that link in their bookmarks and it's taking them directly into the application. There's no need to remember any of this stuff. And so it makes it faster. They can continue helping the customer and getting a quicker resolution as you go through that. All right, so in summary, your security tools are labeled as a cost of doing business, but with planning and integration and a little bit of work and coordination with your business partners on these things, you can actually help build a security solution for the business. And it's something that the business will respond and recognize. And quite honestly, if you're building those bridges with the business, then when you do have a regulation that comes down or you have a security tool that you need to leverage for them, they might be more willing to have those conversations and to work with you because you've shown benefit and value to what you've already been able to deliver as a security group within the organization. Again, SSO is like everything else. It needs to be properly planned, deployed, and maintained. It can't be something that you just stand up and then don't give it any care and feeding for 24 months. It's not going to be able to keep up with what you're doing and the changes in your organization. It helps to have SSO and any security tool, quite honestly, as part of a business strategy, as well as your IAM strategy. And again, your senior level InfoSec leaders should be talking to your senior level business folks and really help to plan and coordinate how you can work together to deliver what you want to do. So your drivers, again, are going to be your regulatory landscapes, security policies and procedures. You've got realized cost savings across the business. And of course, you always want to evaluate your on-prem versus your cloud. More and more things are becoming cloud-based. But again, it has to be a case-by-case decision made on the business. You can't just say we're going to go to the cloud because it's the cloud. You really have to know why. What are the costs associated and involved with that? How do you have to architect the environment to make the changes? What happens if you lose your internet pipe? All things that you need to think about in consideration of that. All right, I talked a lot. That was a lot of numbers. Does anybody have any questions for me? There's microphones, or you can just shout it out. That's fine. Yes, ma'am. The question, I'm just going to try and summarize this real quick, was around the entitlements in the applications that you're brokering the SSO for. So one thing that we've been successful with is our applications that are Active Directory aware. We're actually able to build out security groups based on the roles within the application, and then we can provision to the security group, and then that does it back and forth. We found that to be the most successful thing for us. Okay. Right, I see what you're saying. So yes, that should be part of a deprovisioning process where when the associate leaves the organization, if you have the proper workflows in place, it would trigger tickets to the application owners who would then have that task to go in and clean up the extra entitlements within the applications. That's part of that. Okay. Right, got it. Right, very, very good. Yeah, see me after this. If you don't have another session right away, we can talk. Absolutely. Anybody else? There's other folks coming in for the next session. So thank you all for your time very much. I appreciate it.